the camera, but a few times I did that today, then Zoom started freezing. So I guess that's not optimal. So I'm sorry. So I would like to introduce how one can become an R package developer. But first, a few words. So I've never been in Bergen, but I've actually been to Norway 2 times, 10 years ago when I was a research intern in Gothenburg, Sweden. So because we cannot travel these days, I was happy to go look at my old photographs. So I went to Oslo and I went to a very small place, Evenstad, which is in the middle of nowhere. And I hiked there for a weekend. So Norway was very nice and I hope I can see Bergen one day. But what brings me to this meetup today is talking about our package development. So on this slide, the idea is not to do some self-promotion, but to show that I really like our package development and writing about our package development. So I'm a volunteer editor for our Open Science Software Peer Review. What we do at our Open Science Software Peer Review is reviewing our packages before they become part of our Open Science collection of packages, so that their quality is increased. Then at work, because I also work for our Open Sci, I maintain our dev guide. So dev guide is our collection of guidance and tips for reviewers and authors of packages. Then I also created the R-Hub blog. And as Julia mentioned, she wrote a guest post for the R-Hub blog. And on the R-Hub blog, you can read different posts about R package development, so more or less niche topics. And you see there are many links on the slides. I will share the link to all these slides in a short while. And these days I'm working on HTTP testing in our book. And I would like to motivate the meetup. So why would you want to develop an R package? So when you work in R, it's the easiest way to share the code, the data, the templates you're working out with you tomorrow, you in 1 year, the collaborators you know, so like your colleagues for some sort of small research project, and the collaborators you don't know yet, like maybe someone else in the world will need the tools you've been developing. Then what would you want to learn about package development? And here I'm using wording by John Calder. Because learning about package development is not only learning how to develop your own packages. That would be the first point, of course. You want to learn that to share your code, but it's also a way to leverage existing tooling for other projects. So maybe you can use an R package structure for your analysis. And then if you know how to develop a package, then you can help other people by developing packages. You can start, if you have time and energy, you can start contributing to packages you use and love. Then work and write an R package. And here I'm also using words by someone else, Susan Johnston's word, and it was actually at an R ladies meetup, if I remember correctly. So she said, if you can open R Studio, if you can install a package, if you have either written a function in R or if you can learn how to write a function in R, then you can write a package in R. So I think this means that every one of us can write a package in R. And what is a package? So here I put a quote in French, but I translated it below. So Sébastien Rochette said that to be less afraid of package development, you have to tell yourself that it's simply a folder organized in a constrained way. So just a package is just a collection of files. And then that means there is a question, how do you remember how to organize things? And that's where automation comes into play. So when you write a package this day, you should automate all the things, and there are tools that help you do that, so you don't really need to remember many details. So how would you automate package development? If you remember Clippy, for those of you who have used Excel in the past, so let me introduce you to an actually useful Clippy. So use this package by Hadi Wickham and Jenny Bryan. And this is a logo of UseBase. So it's a package that helps you develop packages. And it's quite well summarized by a quote of Jenny Bryan, who said, to use this package, implement this important principle, automate that which can be automated. Your computer was literally born to implement rule by fuzzy stuff for you. So we will use this package a lot today. And I would like just to show you where the materials of the meetup are. So at tiny.cc/r-package. And if someone can write that in the chat, I would be most grateful. And I can show you the website. So it has three slide decks. And we are in the first section now of the meetup. So we will add some slides. I'm going to do a demo. This is the most intense part of today. Then slides again. At this point, we will do a short break. Then another slide deck. And after that one, another short break. And the last slide deck. So you on this website, you can find all the code of the demonstration, the small snippets of code I will be using, and further resources for further learning. And now it's time for a demonstration. I've put I'm going to follow a piece of paper I have in front of me, which corresponds to what's on the course website. So hopefully these things are not going to diverge too much. And I've also put links to similar materials on the website. So I'm going to go to our studio here. So let's close this project. So this is a brand new session of our studio. And the first thing you would do, so if you were starting developing a package, would be to install the DevTools package. So it will also install the use-based package and several tools useful for package development. I don't need to do that because it's already installed. So that's part of setup for package development. A second part that is useful is tweaking your R profile. So the R profile is some code that gets run every time you start R Studio. So I'm going to show my R profile. So what's useful here is not, so this is useful for debugging, but you don't need to do that today. What's really useful is this part. So here I am telling use this about some preferences I have when developing packages. So my name and my name here, but also my name again in the format that's useful for the metadata of a package. So including my email address and my RSID ID and my preferred license and my preferred version for starting a new package. And so, and this thing is not something I know by heart. So to know what to write here, I look at the documentation of the use this package. Because the use this package, so I'm not sure I've put a link to this. It's hard to open a new tab with this. Just this. Yes, so just a note, when I want to do some setup for package development on a new machine, I go to this page and I just basically follow all steps here. And that's something I've done in the past. I'm not going to do that today. So then a very important part of my profile is this. So in all interactive sessions of R, when I start R, I start using the DevTools package. So it's loaded by default. And I also load these two other packages and I've put some notes in the meetup website to show why I do that, but that's not relevant for package development. So now that I've shown the setup, and you know, like when you learn a new thing, setup and learning thing for the first time as the most painful thing. So if it looks a bit overwhelming, just know that one just gets used to it after a while. So I'm going to create a package today and I want to call it mini package like this. And I want to check that there is no other package called mini package. That would be the first step because changing the name of your package after the fact is a bit more painful. So for that, I use the available package and I type the name and the available package will tell me if there is already another package called mini package. And it queries CRAN, it queries Bioconductor, it queries GitHub, and it will also query Urban Dictionary. I'm just typing no because it's faster. And so it opens various links like Wikipedia. So especially for me as a non-native English speaker, maybe I can choose a name for package and that's actually a very bad word in English. So that's how I would know that I shouldn't call my package this name. In this case, so it shows me that it's not available in GitHub, but that's not too bad because that's just a package I want to create for demonstration today. After that, I'm going to create a package at last using a function called create package. It's from the usebase package, but because usebase is already loaded, I don't need to write usebase. So it's a create package function, and I'm going to create it in my own directory. So what's happening is that this function is opening a new project for me, and that's my package. So what is in there? So just as a reminder, what I've just typed is this create package, and it created a folder, it created an Active Hour Studio project, it created a directory, a file, and we're going to look at these files now. So this is a package that has been created, and it has a description file that contains metadata about our package. And you see it has guessed my name, but you know it's not magic. It's because in my R profile, I wrote what my name should be when I create a package. And I can change the title here because this is not very informative. So I think as a pathway, you should not write the word package. So testing package development can be the name. So then maybe some of you already use Git, maybe some don't. So you don't need to use Git for our package development, but I'm going to do that today just to have some way to show the incremental changes we're doing today. So for starting to use Git, I'm typing use Git. So again, that's use this automating stuff for us. And it has me to commit them. Yes, I agree. And yes, we can restart our studio now. Okay, and just a small tweak. Because nowadays, Rhythmin provides a default branch of Git, the master branch, a reminder of slavery. I'm going to change the default branch of Git to main. So that's also something related to Git that you do not need to do now, but just this. So now that we have our package and we have an R directory, where our code should live, but there is no code. So I'm going to create a first function for my package. And for creating a function, I use a use R function. I'm going to call my function for runtime. And so what use R does is creating this currentTime.r file. And it tells me that once I've written a function, I will be able to write a test, but I will first write a function. So because I don't trust my improvisation skills, I have written my function here. So I know I can test it. So this is a function that will tell me the time it is now in my current time zone. So I've created this file, but this function only exists in my script. It's not in my session. So to load the function, I'm going to use the load all function. That's a DevTools function. And now it means that if I type what time, this function is available in my session and it works. And this idea of editing an R script and then loading your package and testing, well, looking that things work is something that and our package development, you will do a lot. But once you've created a function, I know well, I know what it does because I've created it, but we need to add documentation. So to add documentation for our very new function, we go to code here, and there is comment called insert oxygen skeleton. So if you've never heard of that sounds quite mysterious. And what it does is this, it adds all these lines, which is a structure for us to document the function. So I'm going to document the function. So return current time, and what it returns is a character string. And this means that I want this function to be available to my package user. So that's not an internal function, but not a function that's just for my package. So that's something that is part of the external interface of my package. And writing an example is quite easy here. So the example is what time. So the documentation now exists in the script, but I need to transform that to something that users can install. So I'm going to run the document function.
Miley, we have one question.
Yeah.
Is it common to name the file and the function in the file different things?
Oh, you mean like the iPhone and the iPhone? I think that's a bad idea, actually. I should have called them the same thing.
Okay.
That would be less puzzling, sorry. So I've run document, and it tells me that it has written this file. And I'm going to look at it. That's maybe the only time in your life when you need to open the man folder. The man folder here means manual. And I'm going to open this file. And if you use LaTeX, or I've used LaTeX in the past, it looks quite familiar. But you don't need to write this file, because what's used is this. So you can write stuff here, and it will get translated to this file. And what R does is transforming the RD file into something the user can read. So now if I type ? What time, I get the documentation that we know from over like real packages. So my package now exists. It has one function. It is documented. It's only available in the in this session, because if I go to another session here and I type library many package, or maybe it will work because I installed it from another test session for this course. But let's imagine this fails. It's because we have only developed it in our folder here. So we need to install the package. So to install it, we click here in there is this build tab, and we can install the package. And if I go to my other session, I can type library mini package, it works. And I can type what time, and it gives me the current time. So back to our package. In the build tab, we also have this button, and I would encourage you to click on this often just to check you haven't broken anything in your package. So the checks various things, various criteria for your package, and it's best to have a clean result of this. So you can see all the things that are checked, many things. So I get one warning, and it says here, invalid listens file pointers. So if we go to description, use this as written that my license is MIT and file license, but there is no file license. So to change that, I'm going to use MIT license function. And it created a file, which is here, the license file. And the license file here too. And I could have written my name as an agreement, then it would have my name here, but which might be more useful. And sorry, I use Git, but I forgot to do any comments. So this is not an informative commit message. Okay. Sorry, so I've done this change and I'm going to check that now I don't get the warning. And you see this warning of a license, that's quite a useful one, because if you say you have a license, then it's best to have one. So it's still a bit slow. Yeah, so now we have a clean argument check result. So that's good. So we can keep working on our package. So a thing I wanted to do now is adding a parameter to my function, because now it has none. And as I said, I don't really trust my improvisation. So I have the code for changing this. So here, I'm going to edit my function. So now I have a parameter here, language, and it has to be French or English. Otherwise, there will be an error message. And then there is still the time, and the message will be different based on the language. So just to see whether it works, I'm going to load the package and I'm going to write what time. So the default language is French. So I get the sentence in French. Then I can type English, and then I get the sentence in English. So this is my parameter. However, I haven't documented the parameter yet, which means the users wouldn't know what to do with it. And it also means that our comment check would complain. So I'm going to document the parameter with the param here, our oxygen tag. I write the parameter name, and I write the definition. So either again or. So I've changed the source of the documentation, but for the documentation to be updated, I need to remember to run the document function. And now if a user like me types what time, they get a definition of the language parameter. So that's good, and it seems that our function is working okay, but what if we use it, modify it a bit, and we break it without noticing? So because that could happen, we're going to add a unit test that will ensure that later we're not breaking things that should work. So to add a test, if you remember a while ago when we created the first function, here we were told call use test to create a matching test file. So I'm going to write use test. And that's a bad name for the R file, as someone smartly said, because it's not the same name as a function. But what we really need is for the R script and the test file to be called the same. That will make our life much easier. So I ran the use test function, and it did a number of things. So it added test flat to description, because now we use test flat. It uses the latest version of test flat, because you're learning package development today. That's good for you, because you like people that use TestFat before now have to worry about the new edition of TestFat. For you, that will be the only edition that ever existed. So that's good. Then it created a TestFat folder under test and a TestFat file. This one we don't need to ever edit. And it created the test current time.r test file. So that's here. And we're going to modify it, because that's not a test of our function, that's an example test. So we want to test that the what time function works. And I've written a test in advance. So there's two things I want to test. I'm going to explain that. So we test that what we say is we want to test that thing, and we write code and what we expect for this code. So I expect that the what time function returns a character. And I also expect that when I run the what time function with a language that's not FR or EM, then I expect to get an error message that starts with either. Because if you remember, our error message here is either choose FR or EM as a language. So that's a test. And here in our studio, we can run the test using this button and see it works. And just to create a test that doesn't pass, so you see what would happen. So say I change, for whatever reason, I know add a written statement at the end of my function and I written one. So my function, what time is not going to return this number. So say I run the test here. So now I have a failure because it tells me that what time as a type double, not character. And of course, this here is quite an obvious mistake to do, but sometimes you will do mistakes that are not that obvious and you will be happy for your test to tell you that something went wrong. So now that we can run check again. So hopefully that will not create any new error. And another level of complexity I want to add to my package is that I want to use another package in my package, which will happen quite often when you write packages. So good, we have a clean result here. So I would like my package to have a nicer message, and for that I want to use a praise package. So for that, there are two steps to adding this. So first I'm going to modify the code. And again, because I can't remember how to improvise, I have the code already in my snippets page. So I'm going to replace this with this. So now my code is a bit different because it uses a praise package to create an exclamation at this point. And then in the message we get at the end, it starts with the exclamation. So just show you what it does. So when I run what time, I now get something starting with an exclamation. And it's a random one. So if I run it several times, it gives a different one. So my package, you know, there's a praise package. So in the code, I write that this function comes from the praise package, but I also need to add this praise package to the metadata, to the description of my package. So I'm going to reuse package praise. And it's here what it did is change the imports of my description to say that this package needs the praise package to work. And it's quite important because it means that if someone installs your package from, say, GitHub one day, R will automatically install the praise package for them so that then they can use your function. So we can check the package again. And if everything goes well, we won't get any errors. So now at this stage, we have a package with one function that has one parameter and that uses one package. I think that's a nice minimal product, but no one knows what it does. And it also only exists on my computer. So the next steps for me are to explain what it does and to put it online. So to explain what it does, a very natural thing to do is to create a README file. And we're going to create one with our Markdown so that we can knit it and have examples. So use README RMD function, did several things. It ignored the README.rmd file for when building the package. And it creates this file that I cannot edit. We're not going to look at badges right now, but here we can fill the sentence here. So the goal of my package is to tell you what time it is. So this, because it's a small example package, then this sentence is quite simple, but no matter, like when you write a real package, it's very important to get your README right, to really explain to other people what it does, to people that are not you, and therefore don't necessarily follow your logic. So you have to do some advertisement and some, I cannot find the word for that, but when you make something simpler for new commerce to understand. It tells that you can install it from CRAN, which is not right at the moment. So to do here update, because people will be able to install it from GitHub, for instance. And now it has it encourages you to write a basic example. So a basic example will be this. And we can delete the rest of this file. And here, what it wrote this thing, pre-commit, and you might wonder what it is. So I'm going to show that if I make a commit, I'm going to add everything at once, but include user RMD with my ever so useful commit messages. It has an error because it tells me there is no readme.md, so I need to knit readme.rmd. So this is a useful reminder. It tells me that this parameter is not used because I forgot to install my package. Now it works, and I can get a preview of my README and with the example in the README. Okay, so now I think I can commit. So ideally you would do the commit more often and with better messages, but that's what it is. So my package now has this nice really tracking what it does, but it's only on my computer. So an easy way to put it on would be to use GitHub. You could use other tools such as GitLab or Bitbucket, but use this infrastructure for GitHub is well developed, so that's what I'm going to show today. So use GitHub. And so it's creating a GitHub repository for me online. And it needs to commit. Oh yeah, and something it did automatically is putting the link to this repository in my description, which is very valuable for users to find your package once it's installed. So yes. And my package is online and you could see it. And because we have a README, if someone arrives on the repository page, we have some sort of introduction to the package. And one thing I wanted to change here, I had put the to-do installation instruction. So the installation instruction for your users would be something like remote install GitHub. And I will need to net it. And something I won't check right now, but I think if you create the GitHub repository before you create the README, then that's something that just this would write for you automatically. So one other thing I wanted to show is that I told you that it's great to click on check and check your package often, but you might forget to do that. So it would be nice for the check to be run every time you push something to GitHub. And there are several services that allow you to do that. And I'm going to show GitHub Actions. Also because the infrastructure in use this is quite easy to use for that. So to start using GitHub Action, I tap GitHub Action and I'm going to choose to check standard check. So mainly what it did was adding a badge here. So I'm going to tune it so you can see the badge. So at the moment, this badge doesn't exist, but we will see later that it has a color that will depend on whether my package is broken or not. And it created a file here under .github. It has a workflow file, and it's quite long, but what it will do at every commit, so I'm saying at every commit, because at every push on the main branch, it will run our command check. This means that it runs our command check. So I'm going to commit it to GitHub so we can see it in action. So we go to the repository page. So what happened here is that we now have this tab action. So what? So now what's happening here? So why is nothing happening? Yeah, I was too impatient. So what's happening now is that our command check is run not on my computer like previously, but on this four virtual machines for Windows, Mac, and Ubuntu. And that's great because these are different operating systems. That's also great because I won't need to remember to do that. So every time I push a change, there will be this check. And if it fails, I will get some sort of notification. And now here we have this badge and it has no status, but once the checks have run and they pass, then this will be green. So that's a good indicator for the user, for instance, that there is some sort of check infrastructure in use. So that's one thing. And now I would like to have a nicer documentation, because if you're a new person looking at my repository, you can read the README, but then you don't really have access to the documentation of the function. And also the README, all of this looks quite new for someone who isn't, for instance, used to GitHub. So I want a nicer documentation. So for that, I'm going to use a function whose name starts with use again. Let's use package dump. So it did several things that includes an infrastructure for package dump. And then you will need to install the package dump package. Sorry. And I'm going to build a documentation website by running package dump build site. Okay, so if it needs a package called rag, then I want the package called rag, no problem. Well, let's hope it doesn't fail. But in general, we've used this package, and all this package, what is good to see is all these things. You see that it does this. You have to keep in mind that all these things, it does mean something less for you to remember, something less to learn, because something else doing it for you. So is there any question?
Well, I just I'm amazed sort of how easy it can be. I was developing a package, or I am involved in development of a package that was started a long time ago, right? And there was no tools like that. So it's quite a messy now. But
yeah, and I also learned without Roxygen too, and without DevTools. Now things can be. So let's build a website. Hopefully this time it will work. Cool, so this is the website of my package. So it has a README. It looks less developer faith than GitHub. It has a reference here, so we can click and it shows the example. It also renders the license. So if there were anything special with the license, that would be a nice way to see the license. But again, this this website only exists on my computer. So I'm just going to add this. So this only exists on my computer. I would like this documentation to be online. So I'm going to use GitHub Action again, not to run a check, but to, you know, because with GitHub Action, you can run R code on a virtual machine. You could, you can also build your package on website from there. And for that, I noticed recently that you can type GitHub Action and package them because there is a ready to use set up for building your package and website automatically. So I'm going to add package down to workflow. So now let's go to the GitHub repository, which is here. So we add the, so the Ackerman check workflow is still running. And now we have added a new one, which is going to build our package on the website. So it's setting, and it's going, if I remember correctly, to build it in a new branch, and we're going to publish that. So I hope it won't be too slow, and because this will be the one of the last thing I want to show about package development. So while the package and website is building, so let's say your package is at a state where you want to put it on the ground. So how would you go about that? So the first thing you would need to ensure is that you get a clean check result on your computer, but also on other platforms. So that would be very important, but there are a few other things to remember, but fear not, there is use this checklist for you to release your package. So I'm going to create this checklist by use release issues to say I would do a patch release. What this function does for you is opening an issue in your GitHub repository with a list of things to do before you can submit your package to CRAN, like all this check, and also adding CRAN comments with your check results, all these things that you need to remember. So on the Meetup website, I've also put links to resources of all the things you need to know when you submit your package to CRAN, but this is a good step, knowing that you can easily create a checklist of things not to forget, because that's a lot of small steps. So our package done. So this is in progress. Is there any question until now?
I was wondering whether you were saying that use this is actually very well. It combines very well with GitHub Actions, but what about the Bitbucket workflows? Do you know whether it's
like using Travis and Aveo, for instance?
Yeah. What okay.
Yeah. So
no, I mean,
I think so. I think there are still functions in Usebase for using other continuous integration services, and then there is a package called PIC. So tick. So either using tick or tick documentation would show you other services. So tick supports other continuous integration services, and even if you choose not to use tick, then I think you would learn a lot by reading the comparison of the services.
Yeah, that's true. Thanks.
And for using GitLab, like there is nothing in Usebase, but if you type in a search engine, so, you would find some explanation of how people do that using our studio R and GitLab together. So add this one thing that has finished is our check, first check. So I think if we look at the readme, now we have a nice green badge because we added the checks. So I'm going to show you the documentation of package DOM. Because we're waiting for the package DOM website to build. So the package DOM website, so because you've seen that to build the website for package DOM, I just had to run the function build site, but this gives you the default website. You can tweak that. And I would encourage you to do that, to tweak your website. So and the documentation of package DOM, there is a lot of explanation of how you can use a package DOM configuration to tweak the navbar. So this is this thing at the top. You can choose what appears and in what order. And then you can change, so if this can build reference, I think, here. One thing that is very useful is that you can also group your functions in the reference index. So in our case, in our minimal package, there was only one function, but in a package where you end up having dozens of functions or even a bit less, then it's useful to group your function by what they do instead of relying on alphabetical order like what package DOM does by default. So if you end up using package DOM, I think it's worth learning a bit about how to tweak things such that your website can be more useful for your users. Because if you look at the reference of package, this is what I mean by having a reference that's grouped by functionality. If this were on the alphabetical order, that would be quite a mess for me to find thing to show you today. So I'm thankful for package DOM, the reference grouping. So maybe we will come back to the package on the website later. So we've done this demonstration and in the both in the resources. So let me show you in the resources of the meetup. So this reference and this reference are also walk through how to create a minimal package with use this and dev tools. And then there is also the ultimate reference, which is the game chapter of the R packages book by Hadley Wickham and Jenny Bryan. So you can really go through a new another demonstration. And that's great to start like that because then and then you can add your own code. But you I think there is some value in using a toy package to learn these things. So in our demonstration we used a lot of devtools.all to load the functions of our package, but if we want the functions to be available in another session, then we need to install the package. And for all the things that we did, there was some sort of use this function. I encourage you to run our comment check often because it will show you things that are wrong or could be wrong. So that's a great warning sign to use. So we used it with the button in RStudio. You can also use the DevTools check function, and we have added infrastructure to our repository so that every time we make a change and push it to GitHub, there is our outcome and check is run. And all these things are really a matter of putting things in the right place. So what's really hard with writing R packages, I think what's more difficult to learn, but not impossible, is writing good code, writing a good interface and writing good docs. And for all these points, you can learn from other developers, and I will come back to that later, showing you where you can learn about these things. And for the two last points, a good interface, good docs, you are not always the best judge of that because you know your package very well. So that's when having feedback from other people and from users of the package can be very important, because users have great suggestions about what parts of the documentation aren't clear, for instance. So I've heard it's really hard, but it's also just a matter. It's a matter of learning things. It's not impossible. There is no magic. So you could do more with our packages, more than a package with one function like we did. So you could use your package to share an R Markdown template with your colleague. You could use a package to distribute data. You could package a Shiny app. And for that, there is even an old framework, the Golemverse, to learn how to package a Shiny app. And you could package up your whole analysis in a package. Sometimes you should also use less packages. So I have 2 points to make here. First, if you have a great idea for a package, please check first that it doesn't already exist. Of course, maybe it already exists, but it's not, it's been abandoned. So in that case, your package will be welcome. But you know, just checking that no one else did that already might be a good way not to lose too much time. Then I said that you could package your analysis in a package. If you do that, please also read the contrary point of view, the opposite point of view by Miles McBain, who wrote Project as an R Package and OK Idea. So he makes great points about why maybe you shouldn't do that. So then after that, you can make your own decision on whether to use a package for an analysis or not. So if you have questions at times, so I'm going to check whether package done is done running. Where was that? Here. Yeah, so that's done. So I wanted to show our package done website. So our package done website is now available here in a branch. So, and once that has happened, we can change the settings. Here we go, we scroll down to the GitHub pages settings, and we want to use the pages source. Okay. And so if we wait a bit, so our website should be here, but it can last a little bit before it's found. So by doing that, now I ensure that every time I make a change to my package on website is updated and my package on website is online. But how would people find it? So once I've created the package and website, I need to add its URL here so that you can find my documentation. And it's also important to add it here. So you would add, and later you don't even need this part. So it's important. So if you create your package on website, put it somewhere online and put the URL to your documentation in the right places, because you already want your users to find that first and not the GitHub repository, because unless there are developers like you, then the GitHub interface is not that welcoming. Okay, and that's time for a break. And so this first section was the only one with a demonstration. And this second, but I would like to give links to resources that I find useful for package development. And there are a lot of them, so you don't need to read and use all these things. I think this part will be useful if you find one or two tips that are useful for you now. So to improve your package, the first thing that might be useful is to use automation tools, which is a point that we made during the demonstration by using GeoSpace for adding all the things. And so there are tools that help you assess your package. We've seen our comment check, and there are things such as good practice and lintar that you can run on your package and that will give you useful feedback on things that could be done in a better way in your package. You can also use a cover package. So let me do that and there, I said there was no demonstration. I'm using a demonstration, but so we can do a report. So this is about how many lines of your code are covered by tests. And so this is my function here, and it tells me that when I run the test, all these lines that are in green are run, but there is nothing checking that the code for this line works. So that can be useful for improving your testing. And then in DevTools, there is even a function to find typos in your documentation. And once you have done that, so do you have to improve the metrics by hand? So for instance, when we got a warning because of the absence of a license, we had to add the license. But there are also tools that help improve your package really magically. So I would mention this Tyler package. So it helps improve things such as the indentation of your code. So this might sound not useful, but it is useful because if your code is more readable, then it's easier for you and for other people to read and to find actual mistakes in the code. Then for writing documentation, we use the Roxygen 2 package, and that was quite good because we had the documentation and the R script, and we didn't need to learn something that looks like LaTeX. If you happen to have developed a package in the past without Roxygen 2, you could still switch to using Roxygen 2 by using RD2 Roxygen. So that's good to know if you have an old-fashioned package in your collection. Then we use package done. So I would agree that it's like a magical tool in the sense that when you use package done, you have this beautiful website just is not the right word here, but you have your documentation, you work on it, and it transforms it into a readable documentation. And yeah, you can tweak it a bit to make it more usable. And use this, of course, but a great tool for helping us create tests, create a license without remembering to where to add these things. But when would you use these tools? And that's another point that I think is important because there are many of them. So how do you remember to use them? And we've seen that a bit because we have started using continuous integration in our minimal package. The idea is that something is run every time you make a change. And I like this quote of Joel Aslagi to describe continuous integration. She wrote, "The idea behind continuous integration is that CI, which means continuous integration, will automatically run our comment check along with your test, etc., every time you push a commit to GitHub. You don't have to remember to do this. CI automatically checks the code after every commit." So this is quite great because we cannot keep all this thing in our head all the time. So we've shown GitHub Actions, which is a trendy service. There are other services out there that you could use. And how would you learn? So we've seen that you can use these helpers to set up things. I would recommend reading Julia Savi's post. And there is also a great talk by Jim Hester about GitHub Actions, but the introduction is also about continuous integration in general. And a good thing to know, because we had this default GitHub Actions workflow file, but sometimes you want to do things that are a bit different. You have a system library to install, for instance. So I would recommend another quote of Julia Sogi, who wrote, "Life hack, my go-to strategy for getting Travis builds to work is snooping on other people's Travis.yml files. Shoot out today to the tidier.travis.yml for solving my problem." So really think how people have solved their own problems with continuous integration will help you solve your problem. And you could do more with continuous integration. So we've seen our comment check and package and site building being coupled to each commit, but you could also have your workflow run every Monday. So even if you don't make a change, you could check that your package isn't broken by some changes upstream. You could run something when you apply a label to a pull request. So for instance, you apply a label to a pull request and there is a styler function run. So this, there is really a lot of things that can happen this way. Then there is another tool, pre-commit. So I would like to introduce it with this mem. So a way to do things well would be to always remember to do things well. But then you could use continuous integration to notice wrong steps, which is what we've done. But it, if we do that on the default branch, it notices things after the fact. Or you could use pre-commit oops, but in that case, you wouldn't even commit wrong stuff. And thanks, Mara Avery, for this illustration. So we've seen a pre-commit hook in the demonstration today, actually, but which was not in the pre-commit framework, but it illustrates the idea. So we made a change to readme.rmd. We didn't need it, so we got a warning saying that we couldn't commit because we needed to update readme.md as well. So this is the kind of things that pre-commit does. And in our repository, there is a package called pre-commit that implements a Python pre-commit framework. And the pre-commit R package will help you set up hooks, and it will have hooks for making sure your code is styled, that it's parsable, and it has spell checks, so it can be useful. Another way to remember to check things for your package is doing that before a cron release, for instance, or bioconductor release, because that's a great moment to really make sure that everything is all right. So you can use cron submission checklist. I have shown that use this can create a checklist for you with important items not to forget. And once it's really time to submit your package, if you do that with the DevTools release function, again, it will ask you a question. It will tell you, have you updated your cron comments file? So it's important after a while, maybe you will remember these things on your own, but it's still nice to have to be sure that you're not forgetting important aspects. Of course, you could spend a lot of time improving your workflow, installing all these different things and making it perfect. And in the friend functions YouTube channel, this is described as meta work. So because it's not real work, so there is a balance to be found between actual work, like improving your package, improving your code, and improving your package development workflow. But because you, if you are a beginner today, then I think it's a great occasion for you to have good habits, because you are creating your package development habits today. And so this was all automatic, but to learn and to improve as a package developer, another thing that is important is reading code and reading about code, and this is not automatic. So why would you want to read source code? So it has several advantages. Maybe you want to know what is going on when you use a function. So you want to know exactly what it does. And the source code is the truth compared to the documentation. Then maybe you want to build on a function, you know, to tweak it for your own needs. In that case, you need to read the source to understand what it does. Maybe you're just curious, which is good for you. Or, and that's a bit different, maybe you want to use a praise package. So you will look at other packages that use a praise package because you need examples of how to use this thing in the lab. So how would you read source code? So there is a, of course, there is a package for reading source code, the lookup package. What it does, it helps you read the source of a function locally, if you type its name, but also online on GitHub. Then GitHub, because there is so much code on GitHub, it's great to use GitHub search because you can find examples of things more easily. And especially as there are two mirrors on GitHub that are useful, mirrors of all cron packages and a mirror of R source, which means that you can search in the source of cron packages because cron packages have been accepted on cron, so you can maybe assume that if something was accepted in the past, maybe if you do things in the same way, then it will increase your probability of your package being accepted on cron, for instance. So reading code is great, but it's even better, or it's complementary to trying things out in your own code. But it's also important if you see a package, maybe you could fork it, clone it, and then explore it. And I really enjoyed listening to the podcast episode, Learning a New Code Base with Patricia Haas. It's not about R, but it's very relevant, especially because I found it great that she has these different steps for when you want to explore a new code base. So say you want to contribute to the package.json website. How would you do that? And she says, first, you need to clone the repository. Second, you need to try and build it. And this might seem like obvious, but I think it's great to have this like steps to follow when you're trying to learn a new code base. Then I will make the point for reading blogs. I'm not an objective person to tell you that because I spend quite a lot of time writing blog posts, or of course I want people to read them. So I think blog posts can be useful as a way to see digested information. So you can read the R-Hub blog, where you will find the guest post by Julia about our experience with failing cron checks and fixing them. There are also some posts about package development on the R-OpenSci blog and in the R-OpenSci tech notes. You can also find some great pieces about package development on the Tidyverse blog. Our weekly is a great newsletter, and some of the links that I've shared are about package development. And of course, if you have something to share about package development, your own voice about package development, that's great. And to publish it on your blog, and if you do that, please submit it to our weekly so that more people can read it. Then you can also use the forums or discussion forums where people ask for help, because maybe you will have questions and because seeing other people question might help you and maybe you can help them. So for our package developers, the main places to ask for help are the our package development mailing list. So it's a mailing list, so it's a bit old fashioned. Then on the R Studio community forum, there is a category package development. And there is a category about package development on the R OpenSci forum as well. And there is two latter things are not mailing lists, they are more modern. You can, maybe it's easier or more natural for you to use this this medium. And in any case, if you decide to follow one of these things, then I would advise to manage your subscription and involvement wisely. So for instance, in my case, all these things come into a special folder of my inbox, and I only open it when I have time to engage with questions. Then I mentioned at the beginning that I'm a volunteer editor for R-OpenSci software peer review. So what we do in R-OpenSci is transparent, constructive, non-adversarial, and open review process for packages that are in our scope, and which is interesting for authors, whose package gets better, and also reviewers will learn something about package development. And we have an online book of best practice that can be useful for people participating in the system, but also for any package developer. And if your package is in scope, so you can read here what's in scope, so scientific tools that can be in scope, and you can submit it. And our OpenSci software peer review is actually getting extended for also to another system for statistical software. So that might be interesting to follow. And there are other venues out there that provide review for our packages where you can submit your package and volunteer as a reviewer. It's like the Journal of Open Scientific Software, or our journal, the Journal of Statistical Software. So if you have any questions on these ways to find resources for package development, you can ask them. And it's time for a short break again after this short section.
Great. Are there any questions now? Then we'll, oh, there is one, Alice. Is there one good habit you would like to highlight as particularly important for beginners to learn?
So that's not a habit, but I think I would start by reading the R Packages book, because it's written very clearly. And I think I read it for the first time I taught R package development, and I wish I had done that earlier. So that's not a habit, that's like a one-time thing with a couple of hours. I think that gives a great basis.
And another question, do you know of any common pitfalls in package development we should avoid? Do you know of any common pitfalls in package development we should avoid?
I mean, maybe not like if you have an error, not searching for other people having the same error, like this pairing on your own. So pass your error message in a search engine and you will see that other people have found this being difficult.
Yeah, true. Yes, I want to also thank you for highlighting this R Open Science book for package developers, because I noticed that when I was the reviewer for one package, and it's very, very nicely written book, not only for the reviewers, but also for developers, actually.
Okay.
Yeah. Okay, let's have a break now then.
So this is a session about how to find your happy place in the world of our package development if you want to contribute to open source our packages. And first of all, you don't have to do that. Like, no, not everyone has the time and not everyone wants to contribute to our packages. But if you want to do that, I wanted to underline a few points. And the first one is about the skills you have learned to develop your own package. So like learning how to write R functions, where to put them, how to document them, and learning how to use GitHub or other platforms where our packages are developed, that will be very important for contributing. So then why would you contribute to open source? So there are different motivation. Maybe you just like enjoy it like as a hobby or so. Maybe you want to give back because packages are useful to you, so you want to help them get better. Maybe you do that as a way to train yourself as a package developer. I know I have learned a lot by contributing to other packages. And maybe you want to have some sort of exposure to make your name better known for opportunities. And of course, there are other ways to contribute. Like maybe you can be a community builder or you can write great blog posts about our packages. But in this very slide deck, because of the topic of this meetup, I will focus on our package development, which doesn't mean the other ways to contribute are less good. It's just that it's not a topic. And I think it's important if you contribute to open source to find your happy place, especially because that's something that happens in your free time. And if it didn't, it's better if you enjoy it. And for that, you need to be able to contribute the right amount of time and to find a task that fit to what you want to learn or what you already know. So maybe you can contribute to open source packages by writing your own packages that are useful to many people. With one thing that is great when you have your own packages is that you own them. So they follow your rules, your preferences, and there is your name on it. So this is great for exposure. This is great for, you know, you can put the package name on your CV. But then the risk, especially if your package gets successful, the risk is burnout, is not being able to deal with the incoming requests from users. So I put this picture of a sculpture from a park in Oslo, so your packages could attack you like these babies attack this poor man. Because if you have a package, there will be interaction with users and contributors, which is great, like you write your package for users to find it useful, but then it's very time consuming. So to help everyone, including you, it's great to make your repository a friendly place. You could have a contributing guide to really explain to other people what your expectations are of contributions. You could and should have a code of conduct like our analytics organization has. And if it's a bigger project, maybe it makes sense to add a governance file to explain how decisions are taken so that people understand when, you know, you as a maintainer as a preference for a way to write code, maybe you can write that you are the master of how to style code. Or if you have other contributors, maybe how decisions are taken in your project. But maybe a great thing for newcomers to see how things work in your package. But then maybe instead of having your own packages or as a complement, another activity, you can contribute to others' packages. So that might be a way for you to start with open source development to see how things work. That might be a way for you to concentrate on your strengths, because when you have your own package, often you will have to do all the things, but maybe you're very good at writing unit tests, but not so much as at writing documentation. And maybe writing, contributing to others' packages is what you really want to do at this point in your life, but maybe forever, like that's really what you prefer. How would you go with that? So in, on top of learning the how to develop the packages, it might be great to first watch the repository, you know, see how things are done, like watching the interactions of people in issue threads, reading the contributing guide just to get a feeling for the conventions in this repository. And then you can start interacting in the repository, like maybe making your first pull request, your first issue comment, just to, and then seeing how things go. And what packages should you contribute to? So there are different criteria. Maybe that will come naturally. You know, you'll be using a package one day and you will find a bug, or there will be something you would like to add to the package. And in any case, so having contributing to a package that you use is great because you're a user, so you kind of know the package. It's also great if your package corresponds to your skill set or skills that you want to learn, because every R package uses different, you know, aspects of coding. Then packages that have room for external contribution, because if a package already has a lot of contributors, you know, maybe it's better if you go contribute to a package that has more needs for contributions, where your contribution will be more useful, but also where your contributions will be ignored for less long, for instance. And it's also important to choose a package where your work is valued, where you will get thanks for your work, because otherwise it's quite depressing for you to do that. And I wanted to show examples of maintainers and community thanking developers. So I think our OpenStack is a very friendly community. So as an example is this blog post written by our OpenStack community manager, Stephanie Betlin, where our OpenStack thanked people that had contributed to the OpenStack community during that year. Then I wanted to show a tweet that Hadley Wickham sent to thank Christophe Dervieux, who contributes to a lot of packages, you know, by helping people and by submitting, helping people make their bug reports better by making pull requests. And so, and it shows that on top of it being a very useful contributor, Christophe also chose well, because he chose to contribute to repositories where his contributions were valued. And that's important for your well-being as a contributor. The problem with contributing to others' packages is that your name won't be on it. So maybe your name will only be in the change log. So that means that as far as exposure goes, and as far as showing that RLADs develop packages as well, it's not that, it's not as efficient as maintaining a package. But that means that maybe you will need other ways to still display your skills, you know, to maybe blogging about your expertise, giving talks, or just, you know, having a list of your contributions to other packages. But in any case, that's something to keep in mind. Like if it's not your package, your name will naturally be less visible. So that was a very brief presentation, and I think it's a complex topic of both for contributors and maintainers to, you know, to make everyone happy and productive. So how to choose tasks and how to be nice to each other. And if the topic interests you, I've put links to further resources about, you know, finding your updates in the open source development. So I really enjoyed the book Working in Public, so Making and Maintaining Open Source Software by Nadia Ekbal. And at our OpenStack, we have a contributing guide by Stephanie Betlin and Steffi Lazerty wrote. So it's an old book down about how to contribute to our OpenStack, and maybe it could be an inspiration for your own organization. And in the OpenStack Dev Guide, we have a chapter about how to make your, you know, your repository, how to collaborate with other people in your repository. So thanks, that's the end of my presentation. So if you have any questions, you can ask them now. And I want to thank you for listening and to thank Annalise Bergen for organizing. That was a pleasure to be able to pay you a virtual visit. And I wish you to be happy package developers.